Namaskar, this is Dr. Abhay Kumar from Central Institute of Educational Technology, NCERT, New Delhi. We are going to discuss here the module which has been prepared for the EVS subject, Environmental Studies subject, at the school level. This module has been prepared keeping in mind the forthcoming training program under the Government of India's initiative, which is now being named as NISTHA. We have with us Dr. C.V. Simre, who is the Associate Professor in Department of Education in Science and Mathematics at NCERT, New Delhi. Welcome you, madam.
Thank you.
We have also with us Dr. K.V. Sridevi, who is also with Department of Curriculum Studies in NCERT, New Delhi. Welcome you, madam.
Thank you.
Before we initiate the discussion on this module, let me give you a brief context of the environmental education at large. You know, in way back in 1970, I think it was in 1972, that the world community in the leadership of United Nations for the first time discussed the burgeoning crisis of the environment. And in that conference, in what was later known as Stockholm Declaration, in that conference, which is the first UN conference on the human environment, in the Stockholm Declaration, environmental education was for the first time made the integral part of the entire education system. And later on, this Stockholm Declaration, later on in Belgrade, again under the leadership of United Nations, the roles and objectives of this environmental education were for the first time debated, discussed, and delineated, and what is now known as Belgrade Charter. Later on, for the first time, the Intergovernmental Forum on Environmental Education was held at Tbilisi, which was then part of the Soviet Union. And that was for the first time the details of the environmental education were outlined. It was debated, discussed thoroughly at the global level, and first time it was detailed. Later on, in India also, when these discussions were taking place at the world level, in India also, we find that a similar discussion starts happening. And in 1986, new education policy came up. It talked about the including environmental education as an important part of the values at the school education. And this is how, for the first time in India also, we start seeing at the formal level environmental education being talked about. And later, acting on a public interest litigation, the Honorable Supreme Court of India directed the concerned authorities, especially in the context of the school education, asked NCERT to prepare syllabus for the school education, which should include the environmental concerns also. And it made very important observations, the Honorable Supreme Court, and said that if the malaise of the pollution have to be combated, then every level of the society must be not only be made aware of the issues of the environment, but they should also be well informed to take action based on these understanding. So later on, NCERT came out with an approach which is now known as infusion approach, that this environmental education or concerns of environment will be infused across the curriculum, across the subjects, across the level. And at the primary level, NCERT introduced a subject what is now known as EVS. And to discuss this module, as I said in the beginning, we have our two eminent panelists. I will first request Dr. Simre to give the curricular expectations and the learning outcomes of this EVS module.
Thank you. The curricular expectations are broad, and this cater to a stage. That means that the curricular expectations that is listed down in the module, this is going to cater to a stage that is here, the primary level, that is class 3 to 5. And whereas the learning outcomes help us to map those curricular expectations. For example, the curricular expectations as listed down in the module includes to acquire awareness about an immediate or wider surroundings through lived experiences on various themes related to daily life. For example, family, plants, animals, food, water, travel, and shelter, to nurture natural curiosity and creativity for the immediate surroundings, develop various processes or skills, for example, observation, discussion, explanation, experimentation, logical reasoning, through interaction with their immediate surroundings. Students are also expected to develop sensitivity for the natural, physical, and human resources in the immediate environment. And they are also expected to point out and raise issues related to equality, justice, and respect for human dignity and rights. And so these are very important curricular expectations. And what the learning outcomes are trying to achieve through is that it also has listed down a list of, I mean, numerous learning outcomes which are achievable, which can be easily identified by teachers, students, even the parents, so that they can find out that, okay, we have achieved this learning outcome, and ultimately this learning outcomes which we achieve will help us in achieving the curricular expectation for that stage. For example, here I will just read out the learning outcomes for class 3, which has been listed down in the document of the learning outcomes. It says, for the learning outcomes, the children in class 3 will be able to differentiate between objects and activities of or past and present. They will be able to estimate spatial quantities and time in simple standard units and verifies using simple tools or setups. They will be able to record observations, experiences, information on objects or activities or places visited in different ways and predict patterns. Children will be able to create drawings, designs, models, maps, poems, and slogans. They will also be able to show sensitivity for plants, animals, and other organisms in surroundings. And so if children are able to do all this, we will say that we have achieved the learning outcomes for class 3. And ultimately, we will also be able to link this achievement with the curricular expectation of that stage.
When I was talking about the various initiatives of the United Nations on the environmental education, one of the important initiatives of the United Nations later in the 21st century was when it declared the entire decade of 2005 to 2014 as a decade of sustainable development, what was known as a decade of environmental sustainability. At the end of that decade, I think in 2014, there was a conference in Japan where the world community gathered to get a sense of what happened in that entire decade, what was the outcome of the various initiatives taken in the different countries about this particular decade of environmental education with sustainability. And it is important to, there were 10 outcomes that were listed. One of the important outcomes was that the learner-driven pedagogy helps environmental education a lot. So in that regard, our module also talks about the pedagogy which is should be taken while we are teaching our children about the environment. So I would request Dr. Sridevi to give the teaching learning strategies and also the pedagogies which will be used in transacting this module. Dr. Sridevi.
National Curriculum Framework 2005, what exactly it speaks about, pedagogical practices that has to be taken up by the, school or teachers. Now, it says that any subject, when it is taught, it should be linked to the daily life of the children or the real life situations. And second thing, it very importantly emphasizes that rote learning has to be discouraged. And third important thing is going beyond the textbooks. As Dr. Abhay and Dr. Shimre, both of them have already said that environment studies is basically learning about the natural, social, and physical environment of a child. Look, like, how are we going to do it? Probably that is the biggest challenge that is there in front of us, especially when it comes to EVS. Now, if we look into the objectives of environmental studies, why a child has to learn environmental studies, or what should be the actual outcome of learning environmental studies? That is, the first one is creating awareness among the children related to the immediate surroundings of the child where he or she is living. It's not enough if a child is aware of what is happening in the environment. It is very much essential that he has to become sensitive towards the environment. Because we see that today, we all know that over usage of polythene is not at all good for the, you know, society. But still, many of us are continuing using that. So it is not enough if we are aware, rather we should develop a feeling or a sensitivity towards the usage of materials or towards the environment. Thirdly, is it enough if we are having the feeling? Is it enough if we are sensitive towards it? No. It's something going beyond that. We need to develop an ability among the students to respond to or to try to solve problems whenever, wherever they come across in the society or in the daily life. If we are able to achieve these three levels, that is awareness, sensitivity, and ability to solve the problems, probably many of the problems which Dr. Abhay had listed out would be resolved at the school level itself. So developing right kind of attitudes and environmental consciousness is one of the important objectives of environmental studies as a subject. Now with these things, if these changes have to be brought out among the children, what is the role of a teacher? How that subject has to be treated? As we all know that every subject has got its own philosophy and psychology and sociology of treating it. In the same way, environmental science or environmental studies has to be treated in an appropriate way. When I say appropriate, what does it mean? I just now mentioned that it includes natural, physical and social environment. Then, unless and until a child is given an opportunity to interact with the environments, it is not possible. How is the child going to interact with that? How is the teacher going to provide opportunity for such interactions to happen in the classroom? That is what is, we are going to emphasize on. Now, as a teacher, first and foremost thing, I need to understand the subject first. Once I understand the subject, then I need to understand the context from which the child is coming to the class. To which context? What is his background? Like, what is the reality in which he is living? And accordingly, I need to contextualize the content of the textbook. After that, then keeping these two things in mind, content and context, I need to design teaching learning experiences in such a way that the child gets an opportunity to interact with the environment and learn the concepts which he or she has to develop or build. That is what Dr. Shimre was speaking, that is about learning outcomes. So how is the teacher going to bridge this objectives of teaching environmental studies and which methodology to use, how the assessment has to be done, and how ultimately are we going to reach these learning outcomes? So teacher has to have an understanding of all these things, first thing. And then how is she going to plan the lessons? What strategies or approaches or methods or what resources would help the teacher in bringing out these outcomes among the students? So we'll try to look into these things one by one. Maybe first and foremost thing, I think, all these things to happen in a classroom, child has to be given freedom to speak. Hence, a child has to be given opportunity to express his ideas, share his opinions, so that whichever context from which she had come, will be shared to the class. And while sharing, they try to improve their communication skills. Interpersonal relations will be improved and attitudes will be developed. Respecting others will be developed. Like this, whatever we have listed in our objectives, all these things can be attained. Hence, the teacher has to provide opportunity for communication to occur between the teachers, among the students, with the teacher, and even with the environment. So how does it happen? So what are the methods that can help? So let us try to understand few of them. Like the first one is projects, I tell you. This is the most important strategy that a teacher can employ in the classroom. For that, the teacher has to identify certain topics or areas which can be given as an individual project or as a group project. But whenever a group project is given, again, we need to see that every child participates in the activities. Every child gets to take up his own responsibility in the project completion. So this is again one thing. And another thing, step by step, whether the child is able to proceed or not in the project. For that, again, a teacher has to have an assessment mechanism. Today we speak about assessment of learning, assessment for learning, assessment, all kinds of learning we are saying, but assessment of learning. how learning is happening, how is the child developing attitudes, how is the child building the concepts. All these things can happen only when some assessment mechanism is planned along with it. Maybe a rubric, maybe a self-assessment format can be developed by the teacher with the help of the students and then use it when the projects are going on. In the same way, discussions, I tell you, it's a wonderful phenomenon when classroom discussions are observed. We see that children will open up. They start sharing about, what is observed in the surroundings. Like, for example, when we ask, what are the different sources of water? Each child comes out with different answers. So, we'll get to know from which context they are coming and where are they standing, what type of misconceptions they are having, so that the teacher can plan accordingly the strategies to create a cognitive conflict among the students so that they can correct their concepts on their own. So, discussions are something which are very, very essential that has to happen in the classroom.
If you can list down a few just the strategies, then just…
Maybe, I'll just list out first discussions. We can conduct experiments, we can do explorations. That means we can do, when I say that the child has to go and explore the surroundings, and then with children can conduct surveys. Why surveys? We'll try to discuss on that later. And then we can have interactions with various community members, societal members, parents, grandparents, and so on and so forth. And then role play. Again, role play is one of the important methods that can be used for teaching environment studies. And then field visits. Then, very, very important one, drawing and craft work. Children can be given chance to draw and express their feelings, opinions, ideas. And then, one more important thing which we were talking about is resources. Among the resources, without these resources, these strategies sometimes will not be able to achieve our goals. So, resource textbook should not be the only resource. We always say that go beyond the textbooks. Environment can itself become a great resource if the teacher can make use of it. Then we have supplementary books, we have e-resources, we have audios, videos, pictures, media, entertainment, and many other resources available. So, I think all of you agree with me that going beyond the textbook is one of the important way of proceeding further.
Definitely.
Now, if I have to throw a little more light on…
Thank you. You have rightly mentioned that the studies of environment has got an interdisciplinary approach, and it is said that study of environment is perhaps the first convergence point between science and social sciences. We often think environment in a compartmentalized manner, as if it is an environmental science or environmental studies or environmental social sciences. It's not like this, especially when we introduce at the school level. It is a combination, it's a convergence of all approaches, all kinds of science and social science, and that is where the challenge lies. And as Madam Sridevi has just put it, before we proceed further, I think if we can take an example of water as a theme. So, how can we transact water briefly, if we can just share?
Okay. Let us understand one thing. This is the primary stage where the child starts learning how to, touch the things, feel the things, and express these things. He even tries to experiment when he is exploring. So, we need to provide opportunity for that also. And then, coming to the theme water, I think all of us know, if we have to take up, speak about NCERT textbooks, we have theme-based approach and we have themes like food, shelter, travel, family, plants and animals, and water. Water, as all of us know, it's a most important resource without which we, survival itself is a question mark. Now, this water concept is very well embedded in across the classes and even across the subjects in our textbooks.
Yes.
Now, water, when we take, we have various topics that we find in from class 3 to class 10, especially when from class 3 to 5 when we see. We have sources of water, properties of water, cultural significance of water, wastage, conservation of water, water availability, access and unequal distribution of water. If you see these headings, each heading is, if you look into it, it is somewhere integrating social and natural environment. Hence, when it is taught, we need to see that there is opportunity for a child to reflect upon, for a child to observe things, for a child to collect data, for a child to report the study, all these things have to happen. So let me just cite few examples how exactly we can go ahead. If I take one example of availability, access and distribution of water, a teacher can ask simple strategy
we have
that
to
a
hurry
teacher
it up because we have very less time.
Fine. Simple example we can take that a teacher can start a discussion by asking, where do you get water from? And then we can ask the child to draw the pictures and then let the child exhibit all these things, display these items in front of everybody, and then they can have a discussion and close the discussion. Teacher can keep on asking question, probing them for further details. Like this we can handle or treat each topic which is there in the chapters that are given.
Yeah, so there are different aspects of water, say for example conservation, water as a resource, the entire aspects of the pollution. For all these we need to devise strategies wherein children can understand the importance of the water as a theme, and that is what the pedagogy says. Thank you very much. I would like to end this discussion by quoting Mahatma Gandhi. We discussed the various initiatives of the United Nations, but before United Nations started taking initiatives on the matters of environment, Mahatma Gandhi had long ago said that, I mean, which meant that the planet has enough to provide the needs of the people on the earth, but not for the greed of the people. I think that is the important lesson that we need to understand, and the environmental education forms that foundation for inculcating the values that Mahatma Gandhi talks about, and this will form the basis for the future citizens of the planet Earth. Thank you very much.
Thank you.